It's nice to be here. My name is Nathan Marz. I work at Twitter. I'm the author of Storm, and that's what I'm going to be talking about today. This talk is a little bit different than the other talks because, well, it's not about Cassandra. But Storm and Cassandra are very complementary to each other, as you'll see in this talk. So just some basic information about the project. It was open sourced on September 19th. The implementation of Storm is only 12,000 lines of code. About half of that is Java, and half of that is Clojure. So it's a really tiny implementation, but it packs quite a punch. Storm has more than 2,100 watchers on GitHub, which makes it by far the most watched Java, Scala, or Clojure project. And it has a very active mailing list and a very active community, as you can see based on those stats. There's also been a ton of projects built on top of Storm that have been open sourced. So Storm is a real-time computation system. I like to say that Storm does for real-time computation what Hadoop did for batch computation. And Storm is distributed and fault-tolerant. Now Cassandra, as you guys all know, is a real-time persistence and indexing system that is distributed and fault-tolerant. Storm and Cassandra work very well together. Storm can provide you doing large-scale computation on the fly, and Cassandra can provide you with doing large-scale persistence and indexing on the fly. And they work very well together, and we use them together at Twitter. The main product that uses the two of them together right now is a product built by my team. It's called Twitter Web Analytics. And this product tracks or produces analytics on all the clicks happening on Twitter in real time. And I'll go much deeper into this a little bit later in my talk. First, I want to introduce Storm and explain Storm, what it is, and what you can use it for. First thing I want to do is actually talk about what did we do before we had Storm? How did we do real-time computation before Storm? Well, like many people, we used the queues and workers paradigm. So our architecture used to look something like this. We were doing some analytics on the Twitter firehose, and we would read the Twitter firehose and take all the tweets and put them onto a cluster of queue servers. And then we had a set of workers that would read those tweets, and they would schemify those tweets, append them to Hadoop, and then send them off to another set of queues for further processing. The second set of workers would update statistics on URLs being tweeted by incrementing various counters in Cassandra. So if you actually look at how this works, when we take a tweet from the firehose, we would put it on a random queue server. The idea is that we use multiple queue servers just so we can handle more throughput. And then if you look at an individual tweet, the worker ends up getting processed by is essentially random. Now, the second set of workers is a little bit more interesting, because we have this constraint that we need the same URL to always go to the same worker. Different URLs can go to different workers, but the same URL must always go to the same worker. And the reason for this is twofold. At the time we were using this architecture, Cassandra didn't have atomic counters, so we really needed to make sure that if we were incrementing some stats in some URL, that only one worker was doing it, otherwise we'd have a race condition. The second reason is that we would actually batch updates to Cassandra, so if you always have the same worker doing the same URLs, then you can get more efficient batches. A lot of times we would have multiple URL updates in the same batch, which saves you database operations. Now, there are a lot of problems that we had with this architecture, and these problems motivated building a new system. The first problem is that scaling this thing is really painful. You know, let's say we want to add another worker to write to Cassandra. Well, we'd have to deploy a new worker, right, and make sure that process is properly demonized. You know, this particular worker needs its own queue server, so we'd have to set that up, right? And then we'd actually have to change the workers who are passing messages to that worker so that they know how to pass messages to them correctly. You know, a system like this lacks fault tolerance. There's things you can do by having multiple workers sharing the load and doing failover, but it's all very manual and all very brittle. And then the worst problem was that building these things was really tedious. We spent almost all of our time figuring out where we're going to deploy workers, who sends messages to who, where do they read messages from. When you actually get down to the real-time logic we cared about, it corresponded to a relatively small percentage of the code base. And I think that anyone who is worked with or built a system like this can understand these pains. So this system, plus many other problems we were dealing with, motivated the creation of a new set of primitives for real-time computation. So let me talk about some of the high-level properties of Storm. So the first property is that Storm guarantees that data will be processed. It has an at least once message processing guarantee. And this is really important. Like, a lot of applications just need the data to be processed. If you don't have this guarantee, then you kind of don't really know what's happening necessarily. There are certain machine learning applications that don't necessarily need every message to be processed, but this is an important property to have. Storm can easily sustain millions of messages per second in processing. We had a topology doing this on a 10-node cluster, and there's not much you have to do. It's all distributed, so it works well. Storm is horizontally scalable, so if you ever need to scale a topology, you just add a machine, tweak a few knobs, and then it scales. Storm is fully fault-tolerant, so if anything ever fails during execution, Storm will self-heal and relaunch the task somewhere else. The fifth thing is an interesting property of Storm. Storm actually gets rid of all those intermediate message brokers. So if you look back at this picture, between every set of workers, we have a set of message brokers where we have to route messages through. And the reason we did this was for that guaranteed data processing property. Right? The idea is that if a worker fails to process a message, it can just replay it off the queue. Now, the problem with message brokers is that they're really complex and they're slow. Instead of sending messages from the producer to the consumer, you have to go through a third party who has to persist the message. It'd be really nice if we don't need them, and Storm actually does not need them. Now, the trick is, how do you get rid of the intermediate message brokers and still guarantee data processing? And this is one of the main breakthroughs in Storm for what it provides you. Sixth, Storm provides a much higher level abstraction than message processing. So this list lets you focus on your real-time logic and lets Storm handle the specifics of how messages get passed around, how serialization works, and things like that. And finally, Storm is ultra robust. This is an extremely important property for real-time computation. As a point of comparison, let's talk about Hadoop, right? Raise your hand if you've used Hadoop. Oh, good, a lot of people. Well, I'm sure every one of you, especially if you were responsible for operating the Hadoop cluster, has had times where the Hadoop cluster is just down for hours because you had some crazy stack trace that you need to debug and figure out how to tweak Hadoop so the problem stops happening. But in some ways, that's okay for Hadoop, right? Because Hadoop is a high latency system. So if you take a few hours of downtime, well, you're still high latency. Now with real-time computation, if you take a few hours of downtime, you're no longer real-time. So Storm basically never goes down. It's super robust, and that's just something you need for a system like this. So there are three broad use cases for Storm. First one I call stream processing. So the idea here is that you are reading something like the Twitter firehose, and you just want to update databases based on that stream, and you just discard messages once you're done with them. The second use case is called distributed RPC. So the idea here is you have some function that's really intense to compute, and you want to compute it on the fly. Right? It's too expensive to compute on a single machine. Well, you can implement that function as a Storm topology, and then just parallelize the computation of that function. And I'll show examples of this later on. And the third example I call continuous computation. So the idea here is that you have some function which you want to continuously know the results of. So an example of this is computing something like trending topics on Twitter. A Storm cluster has three pieces. The first is called Nimbus. This is the master node. It plays a role similar to the Hadoop job tracker. The idea here is that you, when you want to start running a topology, you submit it to Nimbus, and Nimbus will take care of distributing the code around the cluster and launching workers to do the processing. There's a Zookeeper cluster in the middle, which is used for cluster coordination. Nothing special going on here. This is basically what Zookeeper was built for. And then on the right, you have a set of worker nodes. This is where your topologies actually run. And every worker node has a daemon on it called the supervisor, who communicates to Nimbus through Zookeeper to know what workers should be running on that node. And the supervisor will start and stop workers as dictated by Nimbus. Okay, so let's say you have a topology you want to run and you want to start it. The way you do it looks like this. At the command line, you'd use this program called the storm client, and you'd say storm jar, then you give it the jar containing your code, and then you tell it the class to run that will define your topology and then the arguments to that class. If you later want to kill the topology, you'd say storm kill and then the name of the topology. Okay, so let's dig into the abstractions in storm. There are four main abstractions: streams, spouts, bolts, and topologies. So a stream is an unbounded sequence of tuples. And a tuple is just a named list of values. Storm lets you put any types you want in the tuples. If it's a type that Storm doesn't know about, you just have to tell it how to serialize that type. And when you're working with Storm, what you do is the idea is that you take input streams and you transform them in various ways to produce your output streams. The second abstraction is called a spout. So a spout is a source of streams in a computation. So a spout could read messages from a Kestrel queue and emit them into your topology, or maybe it will connect directly to the Twitter streaming API and emit that stream of tweets into the topology. The next abstraction is called a bolt. So a bolt processes any number of input streams and produces any number of new output streams. So bolts is where most of your logic in a computation goes. Bolts can do anything from run functions, do filtering, do streaming aggregations, do streaming joins, or talk to databases, like by reading and writing to Cassandra. So finally, the top-level abstraction in Storm is called a topology. And a topology is just a network of spouts and bolts. And an edge in that network just indicates that a bolt is subscribing to a stream of some other component. Topologies are infinite computations, so they just run forever, processing the infinite streams and producing infinite output. So spouts and bolts are inherently parallel in Storm. When you create a topology and you set a bolt or a spout, you also specify the parallelism you want for that component. So this is what a topology actually looks like when it's executing on a cluster. Right? Each one of those small circles is a task, and the tasks pass messages directly to each other to do the processing. Now this brings up the question of when a task from one bolt emits a tuple, which task in the consuming bolt should it send the tuple to? So you answer this question in Storm by providing what's called a stream grouping. So the simplest kind of grouping is called a shuffle grouping. And in this case, it will just send the tuple to a random task. And this has the effect of distributing the load of processing those tuples. The second kind of grouping is called a fields grouping. This one's a bit more interesting. And the way this works is it actually hashes the tuple and takes the mod to know which task to send it to. So this has the effect of tuples with that with the same set of tuple fields go to the same task, but tuples with that different set of tuple fields will go to different tasks. There's the all grouping. So this will actually just replicate the tuple to all tasks. This is obviously something that should be used with care. A global grouping will send every tuple to the same task by picking the task with the lowest ID. There's a few other kinds of groupings, but they're beyond the scope of this talk. So if you actually look at a topology, it looks like this. Here I've just taken the topology picture from before and annotated each edge with the kind of stream grouping used. All right, so let's look at some code. What I'm going to show you guys is how to implement streaming word count on top of Storm. Now, what streaming word count is it takes as input an input stream of sentences, and we want to emit as output a stream of tuples containing a word, and then the number of times that word has ever appeared. And every time we see a word again, we'll just emit the updated count for it. So the first thing you do is you create this topology builder object. Topology builder just provides a really nice API for creating topologies in Java. So the first thing we do is define a spout in the topology. So here I define a spout, and I give it an ID of spout. And then I say, I'm going to read these sentences off of this Kestrel queue at this host and port. And then we give the spout a parallelism of 5. So this has the effect of 5 threads all reading off the Kestrel queue at the same time. So next thing we do is we'll create our first bolt. So this bolt will take the sentence stream and split the sentences into words and emit a word stream. So here we say, let's create a bolt. We'll give it an ID of split. The implementation of the bolt is the split sentence object. We'll give this a parallelism of 8. So it'll be 8 threads doing this work in parallel. And then down here, it says, I want to read all the tuples coming from the spout component. And that's the component we just defined that's emitting the sentences. Right? And it says, I want to read those tuples using a shuffle grouping. So let's just even the load of doing the splitting. So as you can see here, it's the consumer that decides what data it receives and how it gets grouped. This is really how you want to do it. And this is a big improvement over the queues and workers approach, where it's always the producer determining who gets the messages. All right, so then the last piece of this topology is doing the actual word count. So here we say, let's create the count bolt. The implementation is word count. We'll give this a parallelism of 12. And then this bolt will read all the tuples coming from the split component, which was the stream of words. And it will actually read it by doing a fields grouping on the word field. So this has the effect of the same word always going to the same task, but different words may go to different tasks. And the reason we need to do this, as opposed to doing a shuffle grouping, is that if we did a shuffle grouping, then the same word may go to different tasks. And each of them would have an incomplete view of the number of times that word has appeared, and it wouldn't be able to emit the right answer. But by doing a fields grouping, you solve that problem. So here's the implementation of split sentence. This one's implemented in Python, just to illustrate Storm's multi-language capabilities. So at the top, we have a small wrapper class, which just says, I'm implemented in Python, and here's the file that implements me. And then at the bottom, you see the implementation. Every time it receives a tuple, it takes the first value of the tuple, which is the sentence, it splits it on white space, and then emits a one tuple for every word. Right? So it's really simple. Here's the implementation of word count. So the way it works is it keeps a map in memory from word to count. I just used an in-memory map for simplicity. You could do something like use a database. Then whenever it receives a word, it updates the count in the map and then emits the word and count to the output. Okay, so that's it. That defines streaming word count. So if you want to submit this to a cluster, this is what the code looks like. First, you define a configuration for the topology. The configuration is used to tweak various aspects of how it runs. So here we say, let's set topology workers to 10. So what this means is that there will be 10 physical JVMs executing this topology across the cluster. So if you look back at when we defined the topology, you know, this bolt had a parallelism of 12, this bolt had a parallelism of 8, and this spout had a parallelism of 5. So I think we have 25 threads total defined for this topology. So the idea is that we're going to distribute those tasks evenly across the workers. So we have 25 tasks, 10 workers, so each worker will have either 2 or 3 threads running in it, executing tasks. And then we use the Storm Submitter object to submit the topology, and we give the topology a name of word count, we give it the configuration, and we give it the topology, and this will go ahead and upload your code to Nimbus, submit the topology, and then Nimbus will distribute the code around the cluster and launch the workers to run the topology. Storm also has a local mode where you can simulate an entire Storm cluster in process. This is super useful for development and testing, and this is how you run it in local mode. You create this local cluster object, which simulates the Storm cluster in process, and then you submit a topology to it, just like you would submit it to a real Storm cluster. Here we set the topology debug flag to true in the configuration, and this causes Storm to log a message every time a tuple is emitted, which is obviously very useful for debugging. Okay, so let me show this running. Okay, so here's the word count topology I was showing you guys. It's exactly the same as what I showed you, except instead of using a Kestrel spout, I'm using this random sentence spout. This will just emit random sentences. So let me run this. So it's just going to run in local mode. Okay, so here you can see it's running down here. I have it set to run for 10 seconds, and then it's going to shut down. But you just see it's emitting messages. And then, okay, it finished. So if you actually look at what was happening, so here's like a good example. So here it emitted the sentence, 4 score and 7 years ago. So you can see the spout emits the sentence, and then that sentence gets picked up by the word splitter bolt, and then it emits 4. But before it even has a chance to emit score, you can see the updated count got emitted for 4, because you know this is all running in parallel. And then you can see all the messages are just interleaved as they're being emitted. Right, so that's really simple. And just to show you guys an example of what a spout looks like. So here's that random sentence spout. So the key method in a spout is this next tuple method. And this just emits a new tuple into the stream. So here it, every 100 milliseconds, picks a random sentence from these sentences, and then emits it right here. Right, it's really simple. Okay. So now I want to talk about distributed RPC. This is a really cool thing you can do with Storm. So like I was saying before, the idea behind distributed RPC is that you want to compute some really intense function on the fly, and you want to parallelize it across a Storm cluster. So this is what the data flow looks like for doing distributed RPC on Storm. So you're on the left. You're this guy who has some query that you want to do. So what you have is you have a distributed RPC server, and an implementation of this comes with Storm. And the distributed RPC server will take care of coordinating your request with the asynchronous computation on the Storm cluster. So you tell the DRPC server, here's the function I want to compute, and here are the arguments to that function. You have the distributed RPC server acts as a spout. So your Storm topology receives that, that function request as a stream from the distributed RPC server. So it receives that request, and the distributed RPC server sends the topology, an ID for the request, the arguments that were provided by the client, and then the return info. And the return info is just the host and port of the distributed RPC server. So your topology picks up the request, does its thing to do the processing, and then it sends it to a bolt, which receives the return info and then the result computed by the topology. And then it sends a message to the distributed RPC server, here's the result for this ID. And the DRPC server will then unblock the waiting client and send it back the results. So to the client, it looks just like normal RPC, but it's actually happening across a cluster asynchronously. So let me give an example of distributed RPC. So this example is computing the reach of a URL on Twitter on the fly. So the reach of a URL is the number of unique people exposed to a URL on Twitter. Now to compute reach, you have to take the URL, you have to get all the people who ever tweeted that URL, then for each of those people, you have to get all the followers of that person. So now you have some massive set of followers. Then you have to take that huge set of followers, distinct the whole set, and then count the distinct set. It's a really intense computation, and for something like a TechCrunch URL, it can involve thousands of database calls and tens of millions of follower records. When we were doing this on a single machine, sometimes it would take literally minutes to run just for one request. And then when we implemented it on a 10-node Storm cluster, we got it down to 2 seconds for really hard URLs. And we were actually storing the social graph in Cassandra. Cassandra's actually not the best for doing that, but we got it to work. And that was really, really cool and really powerful. So here's how the topology works for reach. So you have the spout that's emitting a stream of RPC requests. So the first bolt, let's call it getTweeters, takes a stream of request ID URL and emits a stream of request ID tweeter. Right? So for one request tuple, it emits many tweeter tuples. Then we have the next bolt called getFollowers, and this takes a stream of request ID tweeter ID and emits a stream of request ID follower ID. So maps every Twitter ID to this, all the followers for that person. The next bolt is called, so by this point, we now have every impression is now a tuple, right? So there could be like 10 million tuples at this point. So the next bolt is called partial distinct. So this groups the follower stream by the follower ID. And then every task in partial distinct will take the set of followers it receives and do the unique count of that set. So the cool thing here is that because it's doing a fields grouping by the follower ID, every task in partial distinct receives a mutually exclusive subset of the followers, right? So there's no overlap across tasks. So now each parcel distinct task emits one number, one count, and all that's left to compute the reach is to sum those together, which is exactly what the count aggregator does. Okay? So here's the code for doing reach. So instead of using that topology builder that I showed before, you use this thing called linear DRPC topology builder. And this just automates all the data flow of, like, you know, receiving the request from the spout and then sending them back to the DRPC server. All that stuff is constructed for you, so you just focus on the DRPC logic. So first you add the get tweeters bolt, then you do the get followers bolt, which does a shuffle grouping, then you do partial uniquer, which does a fields grouping by the ID and the follower, and then you do the count aggregator, which does a fields grouping by the ID. Get tweeters and get followers are really straightforward, but let me show how partial uniquer works. So the way it works is that it keeps in memory a map from a request ID to all the followers it's seen so far for that request. So whenever you receive a new follower tuple, it just updates that set in its in-memory hash map. Right? And that's all it does. And then when Storm sees that it has received all the tuples for that request, it calls this finished ID method. And this will just remove that set from the hash map, count it, and then emit that as the partial count. Okay, so let me show a demo of this. And that was it, right? Like, you can run that and it works and it's ultra fast. Okay, so let me demo reach. So rather than use actual databases for this, I just have some just mock databases just using in-memory hash maps. So I have, like, the tweeters DB just maps a URL to the set of tweeters, and the followers DB here maps a tweeter to a set of followers. Right? This is just for demonstration. Okay. So I'm going to demonstrate this in local mode. So first thing I'm going to do is create a DRPC server just in process. I'm using Clojure here, but I'm basically just executing Java code interactively. So I create the DRPC server there. Now I create my local Storm cluster. Okay, so now the Storm cluster is up and running. Okay, now I'm going to build and submit the reach topology. Right, so here it's just launching all the workers, and right now the topology is running, and nothing's happening because it's waiting for DRPC requests. Okay, so let me execute some requests. So here I say to the DRPC server, let's execute the reach function with this argument, right, this URL. I run it and it comes back with 14. That's the reach for that URL. You know, if I do it for different URL, then we get a different answer. Right, and if I give it, if I ask it for the reach for a URL that's never seen before, I get 0, as you'd expect. Right, and that's it. Really powerful stuff. Okay, so let's talk about Storm plus Cassandra. So Cassandra is a really good database to use along with Storm. And the reason we really like it, well, it's for many reasons, actually. First of all, Cassandra has batching capabilities, so you can do multiple writes at once. This is really important when you're processing a lot of messages. Just so you can get increased throughput and increased performance. We really like Cassandra's rich data model. We make use of it in a few places. The counters in Cassandra are really useful for analytics. Counting stuff is really common in analytics, and it's nice to have first-class support for that in Cassandra. The write throughput is fantastic, as everyone knows, and it scales, right? Its distributed nature meshes really well with Storm's distributed nature. So Twitter Web Analytics is built using Storm and Cassandra. Those are two of the key components behind it. So what Twitter Web Analytics does is read the click stream of all the clicks happening on Twitter. So if you click on a URL on Twitter, that click event immediately goes to our system and is processed immediately by Storm. We aggregate click counts by URL and domain over time. And we also roll up the stats by refer as well. And for that, we actually use super columns. It's one of the cases where super columns was actually, like, the perfect fit for those stats. So we see 100 million legitimate clicks per day, which does not include bots. Bots actually make up, unfortunately, the majority of the stream by far. It's really like insane, actually. So that's Apology. Two of its main tasks before it even updates the stats in Cassandra is filtering out the bot clicks. And that's actually most of the development time was figuring out how can we do that. And we use a variety of techniques for that. It's actually semi-automatic. There's no way to do it fully automatically. We also resolve short URLs to long URLs as part of the topology. We append every click to Hadoop for offline processing, and then we roll up the tasks. We roll up the stats into Cassandra, so that we can query them later. One of the things we do when we roll up the stats is we group the stream by the URL and we batch the writes, and that just gives us increased throughput by being able to do multiple increments for one URL in the same request, which is really common on Twitter because, you know, most of the clicks for a URL are like right after the URL got tweeted. So the Twitter web analytics architecture looks like this. We receive the click stream. Every click goes into a set of Kestrel queues. Storm reads from the Kestrel queue, does all of its processing that I described. It appends the clicks to Hadoop, where we can do offline batch processing. It also rolls up the stats into Cassandra. In our Hadoop workflow, we export the data into ElephantDB, which is a database that we wrote, which is optimized just for doing batch exporting of views from Hadoop. And then our queries will query both ElephantDB and Cassandra for the product. In terms of like numbers, we use a 4-node Kestrel cluster to handle the throughput of the click stream. We use a 10-node Storm cluster, a 20-node Hadoop cluster, a 3-node ElephantDB cluster, and a 6-node Cassandra cluster to support this product. How much time do I have? Okay. For those of you interested in using Cassandra along with Storm, is P. Taylor Goetz? That's him. Sorry, I don't know how to say your last name. Guts? Okay. He's been working on this Storm Cassandra project, which is a bolt that you just, reads an input stream of Cassandra writes, and it will write those tuples into Cassandra, and it will automatically batch them and do all that stuff for you. Definitely something to keep an eye on. Storm, just a few more tidbits about Storm. Storm has a built-in UI where you can see what's running on the cluster, and then you can see really fine-grained stats about the processing. So keep stats on the latency of throughput of every spout and bolt, as you can see here, and you can dig into it very fine-grained on a per component, per task, or per stream level. Okay, I have time, so let me jump to this. All right, so let me talk a little bit about how Storm guarantees message processing. I kind of made it seem magical before when I said that we get rid of those intermediate queues, yet it still guarantees message processing. So let me talk a little bit about how it works. So the first thing is, what does it even mean to process a message? What does it mean to be successful in processing a message? So the idea is that when you have a message that comes off the spout, that message will get picked up by some bolt, and that bolt will emit some number of messages based on that message. So like in the word count topology, for example, you know, the message coming off the spout is, let's say, the cow jumped over the moon, and then the split bolt will emit, you know, 6 tuples, 1 for each word, and each of those tuples is dependent, right, is based on that input tuple. And then those tuples get picked up by other bolts, and messages are created based on them, and so on. So you have this tree of messages that was triggered by that spout tuple that can be arbitrarily large, right, thousands of tuples or larger. And Storm defines a spout message as being fully processed when the whole tree is exhausted, and every individual node in that tree has been acknowledged as being completed. The way Storm works is that if the tuple tree is not completed within a specified timeout, then that spout tuple is considered as failed and it's replayed from the spout. And that timeout is called the message timeout, defaults to 30 seconds, but it's configurable on a topology by topology basis. So there's a little bit of work you need to do to get this message processing guarantee. There's two things. First, you have to tell Storm whenever you create a new edge in that tree. So this is called anchoring. So when you emit a tuple, you can specify some number of anchors for that tuple, and that just creates some number of edges in the tuple tree. So here, this is an implementation of splitting a sentence into words. We anchor each word tuple to that input sentence tuple. And then when you're done with a tuple, when you're completely done processing it, you just ACK it. So here, once we finish emitting all the words for the sentence, we ACK the sentence tuple, which marks that node as complete. So you might think that Storm would need to track the actual tuple trees to do this, actually keep a set of all the pending messages for each spout tuple to do the tracking. But it turns out you don't need to do that. Storm actually uses only a constant amount of space for every spout tuple, regardless of how big the tuple tree gets. So you could have a million pending messages, and Storm is still only using 20 bytes to track that tuple tree. It's a really cool algorithm. If you're interested in finding out more about it, it's documented on the wiki. This is one of the keys for why Storm works, because it's super efficient in tracking messages and determining when they're processed. Oops. Okay, a few more just related things about Storm. If you guys are on EC2, there's a companion project called Storm Deploy, which is a one-click deploy tool. So you can have a full Storm cluster up and running in just a few minutes. It even sets up ganglia for you so that you can track resource usage in the cluster. All the code I showed today is all open source in the Storm Starter project, and that has a bunch of example topologies to get you started very quickly. Storm also has very extensive documentation. Worked really hard on this. Has over 16,000 words of documentation. I think it's pretty good, and I've gotten a lot of good feedback about it from the community. Okay, I'm gonna take any questions. An at least once processing guarantee. Yeah.
The RPC, is that something part of Storm, or is it part of the RPC server developed separately?
Yeah. So the question was, is RPC part of Storm, or is it developed separately from Storm? So RPC is just a pattern on Storm's primitives. So if I didn't implement the RPC stuff, someone else could have implemented it. It's not like part of the core stuff, but it's actually to automate all the data flow of RPC. It's just like a couple hundred lines of code.
So to develop some different RPC protocol, what protocol is used?
Okay, it uses the distributed RPC server is a Thrift server, and one of the drawbacks of doing that is that the function arguments and results always have to be strings. So you'd normally use JSON or something to pass the arguments back and forth. But the RPC server itself is 150 lines of code. So it's pretty easy to develop another one.
So in your examples, when you work out, what is the proper way? Because I know the old MapReduce, so how do you do time blocking? Is there issues with one of these elements reloads, it has to query the total state? Can you speak to that, or what's just the best practice for doing that?
So the question was, sorry, can you repeat the question actually?
So normal MapReduce runs on a set of data, it usually buckets your data by hour.
Yeah.
So in this model, what do you do? Where's the proper place to introduce that bucket and how to scale tests and that?
So we bucket the same way. When we receive a click, we map it to an hour bucket for it. And then we just have then we update the corresponding hour value in Cassandra for that URL by one. With the at least once message processing guarantee, we can increment for the same click, increment multiple times in Cassandra. It's hard to really get around that. But the way we actually deal with that is not at the real-time layer, but at the batch layer. So I showed in the diagram how we have a batch workflow as well as a real-time workflow. So in Hadoop, it's very easy to deal with, it's very easy to make this counting idempotent, right? Because you're actually looking at the clicks themselves, the raw data, instead of doing this incremental view. So we actually have our batch layer like constantly override the real-time layer so that if anything ever goes wrong, it's automatically corrected within a couple hours. And that batch real-time approach is really general. It works for like pretty much any problem. It's something I really recommend. It's a really deep topic, but that's the approach we use.
What happens when the Nimbus node fails?
Yeah, so it's a good question. So the daemons and storms, and Nimbus and the supervisors, they're designed to be fail fast, and they're designed such that nothing happens to the running topologies if they go down for some reason. So we actually run, like for example, with the Nimbus daemon, like if Nimbus dies, nothing happens. The topologies keep running. It's all that happens when Nimbus is down is that it's unable to monitor for failures and do reassignments. So we run the Nimbus daemon under supervision. So if it dies, and we're very aggressive about it dying whenever something unusual happens, it'll just restart, and then it's like nothing happened. Same thing with the supervisor daemons. This is one of like the key design points for why like Storm never like nothing like Storm is like always running because of like this fail fast behavior. Yeah. So the question was, he didn't understand how multiple threads are able to do the partial distinct in the reach topology. So the reason is because it groups the follower stream by the follower ID. So the same follower always goes to the same task. So every task receives a mutually independent subset of followers. So that's why they're able to. Storm is doing the partitioning for you because you specified a fields grouping. And then that's why they're each able to do a unique and emit a count, and then we just have to sum them to get the reach. Make sense?
Which of the
the most complex data model? Yeah. 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 It's still pretty young projects. Yeah, it's a young project, so it's in production at Twitter, obviously, and just a few other companies at this point. So just asking, like, are there more complex, like, aggregations than just counting being done on top of Storm? Yeah, I mean, so you're just asking, okay, I'm not really sure what your question is, but I'll try to answer it as best I can. I mean, you can do whatever you want in Storm, right? Like, Storm is a higher level abstraction than doing, like, queues and workers, which was very common before. So if you did it with queues and workers before, you can do it with Storm, except much better. So I'm trying to think about what we're doing. And we're doing things like, I guess most of the things we're doing are counting, just based on the analytics we're doing. But you can certainly do much more complex things. Go ahead. Yeah, so the question is, how do I know when the computation is being overwhelmed, and what kind of monitoring is there? Well, the Storm UI is really useful for that. So you can see the latency and throughput through every component, and that gives you the information you need to understand when something's being overwhelmed. Something else we do is that one thing you can do in Storm is you can tell it, I want a maximum of this many messages pending on any spout, So we set it to like 100,000 or something. So if it ever gets overwhelmed, like it hits the limit, and then we can like immediately see that on our queues. So those are like the kinds of things you do. Yeah, well, if you want to grow the cluster, just add a node, and that's it. If you want to scale a topology, you have to, right, because we specified all the parallelism stuff during the construction of the topology. So if you want to scale a topology, you have to, right now, you have to take it down and resubmit it again with, like, the updated parallelism or updated code, which isn't so bad. It takes a couple minutes. Working on a new feature called swapping, where you can basically deploy a new topology and tell Storm you want to swap this new topology with this old topology, right? So the idea here is that, you know, if you want to run it at a higher scale, you can do the swapping, and then what Storm will do is it has them both running, and, you know, the new one is deactivated, so it's not processing any messages. So it will deactivate the first topology, wait for it to finish processing its messages, you know, the ones that are still active, right? And then it'll just, like, swap them. So you take, like, a second of downtime rather than a couple minutes. And then long term, Storm has all the information it needs to, like, know when and how to scale topologies. So long term, we're going to have auto-scaling, where it will automatically do this for you. This will be cool because not only will it just scale as your data grows, it can auto-scale to, like, burst in traffic, right, and things like that. But that's long term. Yeah.
All my workload is not equally weighted, so all of a sudden I'm running fine, but both and I got super high priority workload has to come in, and I need to preempt, or I need to better approach and finish here.
So the question is, can you do custom scheduling of workers? So right now you can't. So it just basically evenly distributes the tasks. This is certainly something we want, and it's probably the most requested feature of Storm. Pretty soon we're gonna get Storm to run on Mesos. Mesos is a, I don't know if you're familiar with it, but it's this really cool, like, cluster resource management and scheduling framework. And once we have it running on Mesos, we're going to be able to do, like, more fine-grained resource scheduling. I don't know that much about the space. I know a lot of the other similar products, they try to, like, combine both persistence with computation, which I don't think is the right approach, because, like, the way you need to index and partition data is, like, so different for every application, and the data models are always different. There's some future stuff for Storm for handling, like, state. Like, the state is always a thing, right? That's, like, the key thing you have to deal with. So future feature of Storm, which I hope to have done in a couple months, it's called a state spout. The idea is that, let's say you have some set of distributed state that you want to use in your Storm topology, but you don't want to have to, like, query it externally every time you need it, because that can be really expensive. So the idea behind the state spout is you keep that set of state perfectly synchronized within Storm, and you can repartition it however you want, just like you can repartition any stream. So then you can have that data available in memory and have it just, like, kept up to date automatically for you. And that will actually handle most of the use cases for where you have these other systems that, like, handle the state and the computation for you. But here, like, you actually persist the state somewhere else. You just keep it synchronized in Storm, and you can partition it however you want. So basically, so the question is, how do you get the results out of Storm continuously?
Yeah, if you have a very long-running computation.
Yeah, so you basically just have, like, a bolt at the end, push the results somewhere where they can be gotten, or just push them, like, to the clients who need them. Yeah, so the question is, can the tuples be more than two tuples, yes, they can be arbitrarily sized. You can actually have you can use any object in the tuples. Storm uses cryo underneath to do the serialization, which is a really nice serialization library.
Related to that, are they homogenous or
stream-homogenous? So the question is, are the streams homogenous? What do you mean by that? Okay. So, yeah, the only constraint in a stream, in one stream, is that they all have to have the same number of fields and all named the same way. One of the things Storm has, spouts and bolts can actually emit multiple streams. So if they're emitting like multiple kinds of data, then you just have multiple streams. Yeah, let's go in the back. So the question is, were there scalability issues with writing to Cassandra? I mean, certainly you can't do this on a single machine, so we use Storm to parallelize the updates. Does that answer your question? Yeah, they're real-time updates. I mean, Storm itself, our like Cassandra bolt will automatically batch the updates into Cassandra. Right? So we do like 200 writes at a time or something like that. And that's just done automatically. Yeah.
So how do you support replay of messages?
So the question is, how do you support replay of messages?
Do you have persistence?
Yeah. So Storm doesn't handle any persistence. That's handled by your spout implementation. So for something like the Kestrel spout, right, the idea is that Kestrel is just like a queue server. It's just like RabbitMQ, or it's similar to RabbitMQ. The idea is that, so Storm takes a message off of the spout. It doesn't actually take it off. It puts it into this like pending state where it's waiting for an acknowledgement or it's waiting for a fail, right? And Storm tracks whether that spout tuple is fully processed. If it's fully processed, it sends an ACK to the Kestrel server, or the spout sends an ACK back, and then that will actually take it off the queue. If the message times out, then it sends a fail message back, and then the Kestrel server will replay it into the spout, and it gets back in the topology. The question is, if you have a web server with an open client to the DRPC server?
Yeah, and if you have a large horizontally scaled set of web front ends, how do you then find the proper server to send the response back to the client?
Well, it's an RPC request, so when you make the request to the DRPC server, right, your request blocks until it has the results for you. Does that answer your question? Which server? The DRPC server?
Yes.
It needs to know the request is completed from the Storm cluster.
Storm.
So yeah, when the DRPC server sends the request into the topology, it includes the return info, which is the host and port of the DRPC server.
Got it.
Right, and that's how the topology knows where to send the results back. And all that stuff is automated for you. Yeah. So the question is, what kind of flow control does Storm use in case like one bolt is sending like a ton of messages, like more than the next bolt can handle? So it's actually really easy in Storm. So all you really have to do is control the flow on the beginning of the topology, like on the spout. So I mentioned that like max spout pending config you can set. So if you set that, then you can limit how many spout tuples are active in a topology, and that way you can prevent any sort of like queue explosion or anything like that within the topology. And that's all you need to do. Essentially, yeah. Go ahead.
Well, you know, what if
So the question is, what if the bolt is creating synonyms?
Yeah, so that's basically I'm just extending this question.
Yeah. So you're saying that like this bolt just emits so many messages.
Yeah.
Right? So it's up to you to know what your topology is doing. Right? So if you know that you have some bolt which creates a billion messages for every message it receives, then you probably should set the feed rate like really small, right? And that's it. I mean, that's up to you as an application writer to set that feed rate appropriately. Yeah. Yeah. Shuffle and fields drooping. Fields grouping.
Yeah.
I mean, shuffle and fields are the most common. And then there's global, which sends always to the same task. There's some more advanced stuff. There's something called a direct grouping, where you can actually, when you're emitting the message, say which task you want it to go to. It's much more advanced. But this, the stream grouping function is pluggable, so you can, if you want to like always send to two tasks, you could do that or do whatever you want. Yeah. So the actual message passing is done using zero MQ. The partitioning is just a function that you write. The question is, what's the 0MQ configuration? So first of all, 0MQ has no brokers. It's just a library. So 0MQ is a point-to-point message passing library where you send directly from the producer to the consumer. And I just Storm just uses push sockets. That's all it needs. Yeah. Go ahead. Yeah. Yes. So failure is defined as failure is defined as the tree has not been completed within the message timeout, right? So if it times out, it's considered failed and it will be replayed. Every topology has a timeout associated with it. So it defaults to 30 seconds, which is good for most cases.
Yeah.
A question is, can you have cycles in a topology graph? And the answer is yes. Yeah. So the question is there a metrics API? Yes. So everything in the Storm UI you can get programmatically, which is like latency, throughput, all those metrics. Yeah. Yes. Yes. Okay. Let me make sure I'm not running over. Okay. So this one more question. The question is, you can have multiple streams coming out of a bolt. Can you have multiple bolts subscribe to the same stream? The answer is yes, and Storm will handle all the stream replication for you. Yeah. OK, I'll be around, so if you have more questions, just find me. I'll be happy to answer them. Thank you.